Circle of Life Coalition on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.
Good afternoon, and thanks for joining us. I'm Andrea Horn, the volunteer coordinator for Bayada Hospice. Today, we will be exploring the topic of children's grief and soul injury. Children's grief is fitting for us as we are acknowledging November as Children's Grief Awareness Month. I'm here today with Kathleen Bohannon, bereavement coordinator with Bayada Hospice and board member with the Coalition, Circle of Life Coalition, as well as Angie Snyder, Director of Clinical Excellence with Bayada Hospice and President of the Board with Opus Peace. Kathleen, can you tell our audience a little bit about Children's Grief Awareness Month?
Sure, Andrea, and thank you. It's nice to be here among friends to have this important conversation. It also feels a bit ironic to be here talking about grief and loss. You see, last night, my 9-year-old dog, Lucy, became sick, and all through the night, I reflected on her and what we've meant to each other. I want to take a moment to kind of set an intention that Lucy will be okay. She has a surgery coming up, and we would appreciate all the prayers and good vibes that you can send our way. Thank you. So one more time, Andrea, the opening question, please.
Can you tell our audience a little bit about Children's Grief Awareness Month?
Yes. Every November, the National Alliance of Grieving Children observes Children's Grief Awareness Month. And our members, our donors, and our supporters throughout the country acknowledge this month to call attention to children in need of grief support by hosting awareness events in our communities. The reason for this is that bereaved children are often referred to as the forgotten mourners. And as someone who cares deeply about grief and loss among children and adults, I wanted to do this program to highlight some of the issues around this topic.
What kinds of things cause children to grieve?
Well, the kinds of things that cause children to grieve are pretty much the same types of things that cause adults to grieve. Children grieve over the death of a loved one. They may grieve over a geographical move or a change of a school. Children grieve over bullying. They grieve illness, a change of health in someone they love. They grieve the death of pets. They grieve the incarceration of a loved one. They grieve domestic violence and the loss of trust, the loss of approval, and the loss of safety that tend to accompany these life events. The difference between grief issues with children and adults is that children feel more isolated because they don't have many opportunities to talk about loss, even among their loved ones and their family members. And I think this is understandable because adults naturally want to shield children from pain, the emotional pain that they think comes with this sort of dialogue around grief. In reality, children want and need to know the truth. In reality, they often do.
So what types of things might we expect to see in children who are grieving?
Well, there's a saying that goes, if you're old enough to love, you're old enough to grieve. And I think that's a good opener here. Generally, what we see has something to do with the developmental age of the child. Between 2 and 4, common responses to grief may be general anxiety, crying, change in sleep patterns, clinginess, uncharacteristic tantrums, repetitive questions, and aggressive behavior. From 5 to 7 years of age, we may see disrupted sleep, concerns about safety, repetitive questions, nightmares, physical complaints begin to develop, and behavioral changes may be seen as well. Between 8 and 12, we may see children beginning to understand that death is permanent, and they start thinking about how this will affect them over the long term. Some kiddos will begin to ask questions such as, what happened to the person who died? They'll want details. Feelings of guilt and regret can lead to concern that their thoughts and actions made the death happen. You might hear something like, "I think it was my fault my mom died because I was mean to her." Between 13 and 18, teens are cognitively more equipped to understand and process concepts about life and death. And they begin to see themselves as unique individuals, separate from their role in the family. While they may understand that death is permanent, they also may have unspoken magical thoughts and fantasize about the deceased loved one coming home. They may also delve into questions about the meaning of life and death. So with all this happening for children and teens, we can see how grief can affect a child's sense of security, their physical wellness, and their school performance, just to name a few things. Feelings of shame, guilt, and helplessness can develop around traumatic events. I would like to say that they are, I would like to say that children are resilient, but I don't believe that they're resilient in a vacuum. I think they need support with this. And as far as resilience is concerned, we know that at least three things are important in helping children and adults as well. First is to let kiddos know that they are not alone. Isolation is a common feeling for those in grief, and I'd like to say that's particularly true at this time of year. We are acutely aware of the merry and bright aspects of the holiday season, and for those in grief, that outside world may seem like a parallel universe, resulting in loneliness and hopelessness. So feel free to honor your emotions and not feel pressured to participate in events as usual. It's important for children to have choices. It gives them a sense that they have some power and control over what they do. And at a time of grief, when things may feel so chaotic and out of control, and children may feel helpless, choice is a valuable coping tool. Secondly, children in grief also need to feel understood and to have someone compassionately listening to them without judgment. So they need opportunities for expression. And with this, we need to know that expression is not the same for everyone. Some children may prefer to talk, while others may prefer to engage in physical activities or art projects. Again, choice and compassionate, non-judgmental guidance is key. Children need to feel as though they are part of a community. This may not happen naturally because our society frequently prefers to deny the painful aspects of life. Many people still cling to the notion that emotional pain is a sign of weakness to be avoided. And when applied to death, this philosophy is frequently expressed as "you'll get over it" or "everything happens for a reason." And while I fundamentally believe that a focus on beauty and joy are just absolutely awesome and probably some of the greatest salves for emotional pain, I also know from personal experience that avoiding one's pain can result in something I now know as soul injury.
I hear you mention soul injury, Kathleen. Angie, can you tell us a little bit about soul injury?
Sure, thank you, Andrea. So I can remember the first time that I heard the term soul injury, it immediately made me take pause. And then it resonated with me, and I knew immediately that it was something that I understood. And most people that I talk to about soul injury feel the same way. And although we don't typically think about children and soul injury, I want to talk today about how soul injury can affect children. And so I want to define soul injury as an overlooked, unassessed wound, something that causes someone to feel a loss of a sense of self, having fear of emotional pain. And many times, the barriers that cause this are unmourned loss, unforgiven guilt and shame, and helplessness. And we see soul injury occur in two ways. One is traumatic, and so a traumatic event occurs, resulting in a soul injury and that loss of sense of self. The second way is insidious. So this is an injury that occurs gradually over time, and so over time they lose that sense of self.
And where did this term soul injury come from?
So soul injury actually started in Bay Pines in Florida. So five VA hospice nurses who over a 30-year career took care of 10,000 dying veterans. I can't even imagine what they learned at those bedsides. But what we now know is that when those veterans, those men and women facing end of life in the hospice unit at the VA, what surfaced for them is an intention and a wanting of personal peace, yet they had barriers of unmourned loss, unforgiven guilt and shame, and also this sense of helplessness. These five VA nurses took to the bedside and provided a place for validating suffering, allowing that fear of emotional pain to subside, and giving sacred space for these men and women to be able to work towards soul restoration and finding their own personal peace. It's unfortunate that what happened for them is that it didn't happen until end of life. So my goal in spreading awareness about soul injury is that we can help people attain personal peace much sooner.
Kathleen, can you talk to us about some resources that are available for children and families who are grieving?
Yes, I'd like to mention a few resources for children and families. And I'll start with this one. When Someone Dies, a Child Caregiver Activity Book. This was produced by the National Alliance of Grieving Children. I'm a member of that group, and I believe very strongly in their message and the work that they do. This book is an excellent activity book for kiddos that provides valuable information to parents and caregivers about the impact of grief on children. It contains literally hundreds of activities to assist in expressing, understanding, and coping with grief. If I were to recommend one book for helping children to express themselves, this would be the book. Discovered it 2 years ago at a symposium, and I've used it over and over again, and handed them out and have gotten excellent feedback. Once again, When Someone Dies, a Child Caregiver Activity Book, available from the National Alliance for Grieving Children. Secondly, I'd like to mention Tear Soup. It's a classic. It's richly illustrated. It comes in DVD form and in book form. The main message here is that everyone experiences grief, and everyone experiences it in a different way. And it also goes on to let us know that it's not only important to express grief, but it's vital in healing. And it also explains that there's no right or wrong way to express grief. As long as we're not hurting ourselves or anyone else, there's a lot of latitude. So the main point here is to develop your own way of working through grief and to know that you should honor your own feelings, and whatever feels right for you is okay. Once again, Tear Soup. And I'd like to also mention, very importantly, this DVD comes in Spanish and English, and both are included in this one packet. So that's nice to know. Thirdly, I have When Families Grieve. This is a kit that was produced by Sesame Street, in addition with many, many other kits for helping children through all sorts of issues. as they go through life. Once again, a beautiful book that is actually two books included here. One is for adults in helping their children, and the second one is geared more towards the children and activities. Once again, there is a DVD in this booklet, and it's available in Spanish and in English. So a lot of focus on diversity here, which I like, and the three main themes in this DVD and in the books are: one, talk with your children openly and honestly. Watch your behaviors of your children, especially the younger ones who may not have the verbal skills to express their grief and will act out their grief. And listen to your children. One thing to remember with children when they are grieving: if they appear to be doing just fine, to be playful and only occasionally talking about grief, it may not be a full indication that they're dealing with grief effectively. Children grieve differently than adults, and one primary way of noting this is that as adults, we can perseverate for hours and weeks and months on things. Children tend to fluctuate back and forth. They'll play, they'll grieve, they'll play some more. And so it's important to keep an eye on what they're saying, listen to what they're saying, keep an eye on their behavior, and just know that it's important to be there and support them. Those are the three that I have to offer. I find them very, very helpful. Naturally, there are many more resources out there. And I think right now, Angie will tell us about a few of them.
So first, I want to talk about an easy technique that you can use on yourself or also with children who are having some difficulty with grieving. So we call it the anchoring heart technique. And so when someone gets anxious or they are delivered bad news, you'll notice that they grab their chest and they grasp here because their anxiety is all up here. So this technique, the anchoring heart technique, is really a way to help yourself or help a child to get grounded. And so there are three steps to the anchoring heart technique. So the first is to gently place your hands on your heart. The second is you can close your eyes for this piece if you'd like. So close your eyes and take a deep breath. And the third piece is to just allow yourself to feel whatever it is that you're feeling. And so you can take several deep breaths until you really feel that you've anchored yourself. And for a child who might be having some difficulty with setting up the anchoring heart technique, an adult can come from behind and help place their hands and just give them some additional anchoring. So this is an easy technique that you can use, again, on yourself or with children. What we want to do is help them to avoid the fear of emotional pain. So Opus Peace is a nonprofit organization that the five VA hospice nurses that I spoke about earlier started. And this is a movement to spread awareness about soul injury to the world. Deborah Grassman, who's one of the founders, has written two books, and these may be helpful. The first book is The Hero Within, and this book is really a self-help book, giving self-help tools to help individuals who are having difficulty with soul injury. The second book is a book called Peace at Last, and this is a book that she wrote about the veterans that she worked with, those 10,000 dying veterans, and the stories and the work that she did with them to help them to soul restoration. The last thing I just want to remind everyone is the most important thing with children who are grieving is that they feel supported and that they're not alone.
Obviously, what we have shared with you today is just touching the surface and offering general information about children grief and soul injury. If you would like more information, we do encourage you to pay attention to the slides that we'll be running. They will have information for Beata Hospice, the National Alliance for Grieving Children, as well as Opus Peace. We thank you for joining us and see you next time.
Circle of Life Coalition on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.